So today we are going to take a look at China's economy by Arthur Kroeber. This is part of a larger sort of series that is put out by Oxford University, where they take very basic level questions about a given topic, or at least this is how this book is formatted, and then they have an expert answer in very plain language that's easy to access, but also is quite comprehensive. So just to give sort of understanding of how the comprehensive topics, this is China. This one's on China's economy. I imagine the other ones are very high quality as well, because Oxford University Press doesn't generally put out low quality anything from what I've read. But to give an understanding of some of the topics in here, why China matters, population, geography, and history, China's political economy, agriculture, land, and the rural economy, industry, exports and technology, urbanization and infrastructure, the enterprise system, which is quite an interesting sort of thing. So China actually has state-owned enterprises. And so one of the ways that... So they've effectively evolved into a capitalist society. It's just a bit distinct from Western liberal democracies, which they're more of a market capitalism, and China's more of a state capitalism. What China has is state-owned enterprises. So they have firms that operate under a normal capitalistic market structure, but these firms are owned by the state, and they are for-profit as part of the state. And so what this allows is, and there's more than one, and this is significant, a lot of the inefficiency of something, of state-owned things, is the lack of competition. Makes there be less incentive for them to be, you know, streamlined and efficient. So China's enterprises, they compete with other ones, other firms that are both public and private, so other, even other state-owned enterprises. And so in doing that, you have a lot of competition, and so you create a lot of efficiency. However, in the case of China, they also, to some degree, prop up their state-owned enterprises and don't let them fail. And when they're doing that, by not allowing the inefficient ones to fail, you create inefficiency. So perhaps being heavily, having a very large amount of your economy in state-owned enterprises is not tenable long-term economically. But for now, they are kind of getting the best of both worlds, wherein the government owns a large portions of certain sectors, particularly heavy industry and increasingly technology, not as much consumer goods. They use a market system, so the market determines the prices and the values of things, and then by using that market system, they are able to be quite efficient relative to, in the communism structure, when prices were determined by the government. Anyways, they've been transitioning away from that since 1979. And so, all right, back to the chapters again. The government finance system. So they have quite a bit of central control over the banks, which is something that, again, the way to just conceptualize how China approaches, or has been approaching things, is that they are trying to use all of the market mechanisms that have made economies of Western democracies particularly powerful, while still maintaining as much centralized control as possible. So that's kind of the paradigm. The financial system, energy and the environment, they use a lot of coal. Demographics and the labor market, the emerging consumer economy, the social compact, income inequality is pretty bad there, the changing growth model, China and the world is conflict inevitable. So it's a wide variance of topics. I think that a lot of people have misconceptions regarding the way China's economy works, and this really, I feel, elucidated a lot. Just very large depth how it works. The book is around excluding appendices, it's 331 pages, excluding appendices and footnotes, which adds like another close to 100 pages. So another thing that I think was particularly striking, in addition to how they use state-owned enterprises to leverage both having state oversight and control, and also having using market systems to be efficient. Another thing I found particularly interesting was kind of the political system. China's fairly repressive and authoritarian. You know, they don't, the press is very much not free there, and it's, to some degree, the people of China don't seem to mind this as much as long as the economy is doing well, which the author said is potentially having to do with kind of being like similar to cultural regress of like Mandate of Heaven. Although he was very tentative, he was just kind of offering that up, right, which was like an interesting tidbit. They are very repressive. They crack down on people who are criticizing them. The press isn't free. There's a lot of censorship, which makes it so a lot of digital companies, for example, in the U.S., just don't operate in China as a consequence of, you know, their repressive state-controlled media, which, again, state control. They are very bureaucratic, so they're not, unlike most totalitarian or authoritarian regimes are dictatorships. And China is a significant difference. China is very bureaucratic. And so, like, there have been, I think, two peaceful transfers of power since 79, wherein someone who is not a relative of the person who is leaving office joins office. And there's also, for example, age limits on politicians. Once you're past a certain age, you're not allowed to serve in certain positions, which I think is a fairly good, you know, sort of mechanism, because I think after a certain point, you've acquired a lot of political power, clout, and that sort of stuff, but the brain's starting to go, so I think a lot of politicians kind of stay in office beyond when they are, you know, firing on all cylinders, and so I found that good. The flip side to this is, though they are, you know, bureaucratic, they're shifting more dictatorial under Xi Jinping. So, like, for example, he abolished term limits for presidents, which was, like, obviously so he could serve more terms, right? And he's also increasingly aggressive in terms of foreign policy. The book doesn't really talk that much about foreign policy, but, for example, they have been, like, building forts, like, using a bunch of, like, soil and rocks and stuff to expand reefs and then building fortifications on them all throughout the South Chinese Sea. You know, they're looking at taking over Taiwan, which, you know, somewhat in their defense. This is an interesting, both Taiwan and the People's Republic of China lay claim to the same territory, okay? Taiwan was the old Republic of China that during the Civil War was pushed back by Mao all the way to the island of Taiwan, okay? So they are the old government that managed to avoid complete annihilation. They still claim to own all of mainland China as part of their territory. Most countries don't recognize the Republic of China or Taiwan as the legitimate ruler of this area, and they acknowledge the People's Republic of China, or what most people just call China, you know, as the ruler of all this area. And so China wants to take Taiwan. That's kind of a larger political thing, less to do with the economics. I think one of the big points of the economics to like drive, like, to emphasize is that China's not a communism in the sense that most people understand communisms. Their social programs are not like, when most people talk about, in the United States, talk about social programs and communism and socialism, they talk about these wide entitlement programs. That's not what China's doing. You know, you could be critical of the state owning a lot of the industry and that creating inefficiency, and like you can make that sort of critique. But they're not a communism in the traditional sense of the word, even though, you know, it's still the Chinese Communist Party. They're communist in name only. You know, a lot of their social safety nets kind of come from guaranteed employment more than anything else, using state-owned enterprises. Although this shifted a little while back, I can't remember the details. But for the most part, they are not especially, you know, progressive in terms of their social entitlement programs or their social programs, which is not really communism anyways. Because communism is, the state owns everything and they determine the prices for everything and determine how much people get paid rather than letting markets do it. And so an example of when China was shifting is they would have goods that were, they had a fixed price and this is how much you charge for it. So let's say it's an umbrella. And when they shifted, they did it sort of like half and half where the first X of these umbrellas are really, really cheap. And then after that, the market decides. And the market price is way more expensive. So they had problems with, corruption, where bureaucrats would buy up all the umbrellas at the fixed price, and then the market price would take over, and then they'd sell it and make a killing. So there's a lot of, you know, sort of pillaging of, or not pillaging. There was a lot of opportunistic and corrupt sort of extracting of wealth during the transition from, you know, a command economy to a market economy. But for the most part, China is now a market economy, although there's a little bit with their currency is, I think somewhat recently they did some stuff to that was not very market oriented with their currency to make it have a certain sort of trading value, which kind of makes foreign investors a little bit nervous about that. But other than that, they are, you know, a market society, not a communist in traditional understanding. And to the extent that they have switched, in large part explains why they have been so successful, growing like 8 to 10% a year for quite a while up until recently, where they've slowed down to like 7 or 8% a year. They're going to slow down a bit more, because you get a lot from being backward and then getting all the technological advancements, but they're pretty up to like snuff at this point, so there's that. So let's get into the ratings, because I think I've babbled a little bit too long. So for utility, I gave it a 4. I actually think this might just be a little high. I don't think that knowing this stuff will come up that often. I think that if you're having a conversation about China's economy and you don't know about some of the things in this book, you're likely to just be wrong. Based on like most conversations I have with people who talk about China's economy, they just actually don't understand what's going on like at all. And so to that degree, I think it's useful if you're going to talk about China's economy. Also, part of this utility rating is a little forward-thinking. I think knowing more about what's going on in China is going to become increasingly relevant to the layperson as China becomes potentially more of a adversary to the United States. This is like for people in the United States, or also, I guess, liberal democracies. Although a lot of this sort of adversarial stance has happened under Xi Jinping, and so maybe if someone else is in office, things would be a little bit different. But there's very concerning things about what China's doing. Like, they're given the opportunity, they're probably going to try and take over Taiwan. They're currently engaged in genocide with the Uyghurs, although that's a large political discussion that's outside the context of talking about their economy. So knowing more about China might be more useful, and kind of a lot of people like to talk about the point of difference between China and the United States is that China's a communism and we're, you know, a capitalism, and that's just like, that's not the substantive point of difference. They are the substantive point of difference is that they are repressive and authoritarian, and you know there's not a free press and that sort of thing. So you can't be critical of the government. Anyways, novelty, 5.5. This is, I think a lot of people don't, perhaps don't have the, this would be new to them, some of the information about how China's economy works. That being said, if you don't read this, this is not the end of the world. It's quite thick, you know, a read for maybe not really giving you too much in terms of, like, usefulness, other than the, like, TLDR, big, like, picture points. For entertainment, I gave it 3.5. It's not written in a hyper-dry way, but it is a hyper-dry topic in a lot of places. Some of the stuff where it's talking about, like, broader political implications, like, is China going to be a problem for the West or something like that? Let's find the name of that chapter. So for some of those broader things, perhaps it's a little more entertaining because it's, you know, more imagination involved. China and the world, is conflict inevitable, is the name of the chapter. So another thing is, all these chapters, for the most part, you can read them on their, like, on their own, so you could get this and treat it more as a reference book and read through the questions and be like, oh, is that question one I want answered, such as how important is the private sector, how has the private sector evolved, you know, that sort of stuff. You could just read the questions you want answered and go from there, and maybe that's a better approach to reading the book as opposed to cover to cover. For style, I gave it a 7. It's fairly well written, readable 8. You know, it's well put together. You can tell that there's been a lot of, to the degree that the author is an expert, there has been, that is perhaps not, when you become an expert, sometimes you forget how much of an expert you are, and you're not very good at explaining things to lay people. Whatever, either the author is very good at explaining things to lay people, or there's enough editorial oversight that the more technical language and sort of ways of explaining things are not really in there. I imagine it's a combination of the two. And for interest, I gave it a 7. I think it's, you know, interesting to... So, like, one of the problems is like, when we think of other countries, we kind of just think of them in terms of our country, and this is the result of a prototype effect. So, for example, when United States citizens are asked to rate how similar is Mexico to the U.S., they will give a lower number than if asked to rate how, or sorry, they will give a higher number than if asked to rate how similar is the U.S. to Mexico, even though those two numbers should be the same. And the reason why is because, generally speaking, you view your own country as a sort of prototypical country that other countries are just similar to, and so you will rate other countries as being quite similar to that country, rather than your country being the same level of similarity to that country. So the which direction it's going matters because of a prototype effect. So when you think of global affairs, we are prone to thinking of other countries as just being very similar to ours. And, you know, there's a lot of differences in terms of how China works, even though they're using an economic system that is basically... The underwriting structure is the same as ours. You know, it's a market economy. And so this is very interesting in, like, in two ways. Like, one, if you just assume they're a market economy, seeing all the ways in which they're different is tremendously interesting. And the ways in which they try and leverage the state having as much power as possible, and where this is good, generally speaking, it makes them better at responding to crises. And where it's bad, also, it makes it so they can kind of do what they want in terms of, like, pushing particular agendas. And where it's bad, in terms of you hemorrhage efficiency when you're doing this. And so that stuff is interesting. It's also interesting if you just think that China's a communism, because it's not. I mean, it's ruled by the Communist Party, but, like, if you are defining communism in terms of, you know, owning the means of production, I think at this point over 50% of China's like economic activity, pretty sure this is correct, is privately owned. So it's not the state owns everything and decides the price of everything, and you just have like horrible things happen because like there's food shortages, not enough farmers, that sort of thing. That's not what's going on in China. China's, you know, they use market system. So as far as who I would recommend this book to, anyone who wants to have an intelligible conversation about China's economy. So this is going to lean towards people who are interested in politics and having political discourse. It's perhaps people are just interested in economics in general. Although it's, you know, it's relatively dry and a very large book, and it might not be the best like economics book you could read. So the band of people who I think this book is for is very narrow, but I think that, you know, the two understanding China's political system as being, you know, bureaucratic or authoritarian, and their economic system as being state capitalism, and just kind of having those two just very short explanations, I think that's pretty useful. And so that's kind of why I tried to talk longer in this video, just about those things conceptually, just trying broad strokes. I think that, you know, past getting those two points, maybe this isn't a read that should be very widely done, but I think it's very well organized, and very clear and very accessible to the layperson. So, if you're interested in China's economy, this would be an interesting read. But also, the What You Need to Know series that Oxford puts out, if there's other sorts of maybe political or like world issues that you're interested in, I would recommend perhaps looking into that sort of series as an avenue to finding information that is very well vetted by experts, but put forth in a way that's very accessible to the layperson. So, like, a lot of times you get information that's not well vetted, and it's not really by experts, and it's very accessible, but it's not very good information. And then other times you get information that's very high quality, but it's not accessible to layperson. And so I think that the cross section of this is pretty good. And if every what everyone needs to know book has the same sort of styling, I think that this is probably a pretty good series to look at in terms of finding books on these sorts of issues. Like, there's for almost every country or conflict, there is a book on this, and then there's like also on like cyber warfare, drones, terrorism, a lot of things. As far as discussion goes, who here thought that China was operating under like a sort of command economy type of thing, or was dictatorial, like authoritarian dictatorial in nature? This is just kind of like a pulse check, or not a pulse check, but like I'm just curious, like, how many people thought this or still think this? That's fair too. Where it's often when I have conversations about China with people, they will, you know, sort of, how do you put this? They will sort of not have a very nuanced or textured understanding of what China's economy is, and instead will kind of communicate in terms of like, not like bullet points, but almost just like canned lines of like, oh, it's a communist, and like, it's, which, yeah. Anyways, so, also, if there's any interest in perhaps my reading another one of these What You Need to Know series, on a different sort of country or topic, that's something I'm exploring. So if anyone has special requests, that'd also be fine piece for discussion. If you like the video, feel free to like. If you want to see more, subscribe, and have a good one.